I'm Tony, he's Mike, and just in case you didn't find anything you hadn't already seen on our five quick and dirty Halloween horror spectacular reviews, Mike and I put together a list of some other films that you might be considering watching for Halloween and our thoughts on them. So you want to kick off with number 10? And we'll just go back and forth?
I didn't make 10. I don't have 10.
Oh, well, you got five and I've got five.
Well, I barely got five. I really got four and kind of an honorable mention. So I'll start off with No One Will Save You, which is on Hulu right now. It's the sci-fi horror kind of thing. It's unique in the fact that the girl doesn't speak but like one or two lines of dialogue in the whole movie. She's silent through the whole thing, and pretty much just about everybody else is silent in the movie for the most part.
Okay.
And it's kind of interesting in that regard. It's unique, but it's kind of like it's only card that it's got. And it builds up a lot of tension for like the first like half hour. Does really well, but the problem is it builds up to that level and then it just stays at that level. It doesn't escalate, doesn't de-escalate.
So
and there's so many contrivances in this film, like this, like she gets out of so many situations where she should have been snatched, she should have been abducted and all this shit, that you just kind of lose interest. Like after about half hour, I was like, okay, I don't know how this is going to end, but I know that she's going to be okay in the end.
Yeah.
And sure enough, she's perfectly fine in the fucking end. That's not really spoiling it. if you kind of think it is, I'm sorry. But there's a whole weird wackadoo end to it that I'm just kind of like, you know what? Fuck you, movie. So, I don't know. If you like aliens, you may enjoy this. If you're looking for a unique take, you may enjoy it. But just know this, that I don't know. If you can maintain that same level of tension all the way through, more power to you.
So,
not recommend.
So, the first movie I'm going to talk about is a movie called Blood Quantum.
This planet we're on is so sick of our shit. That's why the dead keep coming back to life.
You're immune. I'm not. What if my baby isn't either?
It's bad. I heard that you could cure bites here.
Ain't nobody immune here but us.
One of them could come in here and infect this entire camp.
Who says we're immune?
And this is a zombie film where it's discovered that Native Americans have a resistance to the Zed virus that's turning everybody else in. So they're like the last standing survivors in
this
Canadian community. It's actually set in the 80s, but the movie was made in 2019.
Okay.
And the reason behind the title Blood Quantum was the government literally came up with a way for Native Americans to actually be able to determine or prove their ancestry was Native American or Native in order to receive benefits from the government. So that's the origin of the title. But I will say this. There are so many schlocky, lazy zombie movies. This movie's actually smart. It's surprisingly interesting in that they have this little community that they've built up after, you know, the whole zombie thing has wiped everything out. And they want people to come to them. They want to let survivors in, but they have to screen them so hard to make sure that they're not hiding anything from them. And there's a couple of instances where they actually show people that are trying to sneak in that have been bit. Mm-hmm. It's far better than it has any business being. The ending of it, which I'm not gonna give anything more away than that. I'm just gonna say that the ending of this is incredibly fucked up and incredibly satisfying at the same time. And I was just kind of like, how did this fly under the radar? How come I've never heard of this before?
2019, pandemic. Yeah.
2019 and a Canadian film, which is to say that you know, just like the Rousedower, it takes somebody else to unearth these films and let you know, hey, yeah, you should check this one out.
Where can you watch those?
This one is, I believe it was on Shudder. It was either on Prime or on Shudder, and I don't remember which one of them, but I know that it was on Amazon. And this is one that it's not too far gone. It's not too violent. It's not too graphic. It's not too bloody. Mm-hmm. If you have a crowd of people and they're experienced horror watchers, this is definitely a movie that you can throw on that most of them probably haven't seen before. So if you're having a Halloween party, this is one you might want to definitely consider for that. It is a recommend for me.
Okay.
So.
Cool. Next one I got here is The Blackening. All y'all
enjoy me the song. You still a slave to the white man?
Y'all gonna start calling my wife the white man, all right? Newness is the
end. Oh, hell no.
Where are you going?
Look for the fuse box.
No, thank you.
The Blackening?
Whoa!
Pick a card and save Morgan.
What do you mean, save Morgan?
Refuse to play, and she dies. Big money, play boy, your
time's up. We need a plan.
Don't say it. Don't you dare.
Don't say this, don't say it.
We have to split up.
There's a crazy person out here hunting us. You got Rosa Parks on your shirt, right? Would she be sitting down right now?
I mean, that's exactly what she did. Oh, I made you look.
I think I've seen this film, but I need you to tell me a little more about it.
I watched this on Prime. I'm not sure. But anyways, it's what you kind of what you expect. It's a instead of like a group of white people going to a cabin out in the middle of nowhere and getting picked off one by one, it's a group of black people going to a cabin getting picked off one by one. There's some funny parts in it. It's got kind of a mixed tone though. When they're trying to deliver some type of message, like they really like hammer. It's very ham-fisted in it.
It's a horror film. They want to make sure you didn't miss the fact that they had something to say.
I don't know. It's good when it doesn't take itself seriously. When it's presented more as like scary movie or something like that, it's fine and it's funny. But when they try to say something, it's like.
It's a parody that forgets it's a parody.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. It's like, you guys missed out. So. Some people may enjoy it. I think if you're kind of like just a casual watcher of movies, you may get some entertainment out of it. I didn't care for it too much. It's not a recommend. It's not like an avoid either. It's just kind of there. You know, do with it what you will.
Turn it on for background noise kind of movie.
Yeah, turn it on for background noise. Yeah.
The next movie I got for you is 2016, A Dark Song. Now, this movie's creepy. There's no other way to say it. And basically, the premise is that there is a woman whose 7-year-old son died, and she has this house in the middle of nowhere, and she's hiring this guy who's supposed to be a supernatural expert to come and basically perform this ritual that's going to allow her to talk to her 7-year-old son again. Mm-hmm. And the whole movie is basically the ritual of that for the big reveal. I don't want to say anything more than that, but I'm going to tell you that as far as a supernatural film goes, because it starts off and it's perfectly paced in that you don't know if she's being scammed, if he's a confidence man that's just basically trying to rip her off in her grief. Mm-hmm. But it turns out that he actually does know what he's talking about. And it just builds in this really interesting, dark visual way, never feels over the top. And then when it gets to the very end, the ending of this is really freaky and dark and weird. And if supernatural films are your jam, if you want a really good, solid ghost story, this will fit the bill. It's also, if you're like into like witches or witchcraft or that sort of thing, again, this will scratch that itch. This is a high recommend from me.
What's this called again?
It's called A Dark Song.
What was it on?
It was actually on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
So it is.
Well,
it
shit,
is,
you got my interest on
yeah,
this one.
Yeah. It is dark. It is entertaining. It's two lead actors. The performances are so damn good. It is a slow burn. It is most definitely a slow burn.
And it is
going to be one of those films that like the first 15 minutes you're going to be like figuring out who these people are, and the next 15 minutes you're going to be like, well, what's going on here? And then the next hour, just sit down and watch. Just don't say nothing. Just shut up. Watch the movie. The payoff is spectacularly good. And I'm just going to leave that one right there. So.
I wish I watched your movies because most of my movies suck. Speaking of movies that suck, this is another new one. This one is, I can't remember if it's on Prime or if it's on Hulu. I want to say it was on Prime. Totally Killer.
How about we all stay in and hand out Halloween candy?
No, Mom.
You know how hard this time of year is for us.
Your friends were murdered 35 years ago.
It's not 1987 anymore.
What the fuck?
Excuse me, what year is it?
1987.
Oh my God. I know.
The 80s are almost over and I haven't even tried Coke yet.
This is a creepy ass cabin in the middle of fucking nowhere.
What's the big deal?
There's a murderer on the loose and you drove us into the woods. Oh my God!
What?
I forgot to bring vodka.
Water's warm.
Just so you know,
I don't do blowjobs.
You pee out of that thing.
Just think, maybe if she did do blowjobs, she'd still be alive.
Yeah, let's not make that the lesson.
It's got the young daughter from Mad Men in it. She's not a
Karen Shipka.
That girl. So it's like it's part Happy Death Day, part, you know, Back to the Future type of thing, you know. So
okay.
It's like there's a murder that happens in the past, and her genius buddy invents a time machine that's a photo booth, and she accidentally goes back in time. Well, she can help save her mother from dying and her group and her friends from dying.
So it's Groundhog Day. No, it's Edge of Tomorrow, but with Kiernan Shipka.
but they don't. It doesn't repeat. She's back there. Once.
Okay.
So there's no repeating in it. But I got. It's so dumb, and they're so lazy with their science. Like, you know, at least like in Back to the Future, you kind of believe that, you know, he made a
change. Yeah. Their techno babble made a certain amount of sense.
Yeah. This is like there's no techno babble. So the time machine has to have Wi-Fi to work. Okay, and so
you can only go back to 2001.
Well, they go back further than that to time where there is no Wi-Fi. But yet they're trying to feed me some bullshit that, oh, well, there's a thing that transmits RF, that's Wi-Fi. It's like, no, RF is like this whole frequency, you know, it's a catch-all.
Spectrum, yes.
for a radio frequency, okay? Yes, Wi-Fi is a radio frequency, but it's two specific frequencies.
Yeah.
You know, in the 2.4 gigahertz range, there's the 5 gigahertz range. Yeah, so
yeah.
No. You and your fucking science is maybe bullshit.
That's not even science. That's just that's a Wikipedia article search. So.
And it's like, you know, so I got, you know, my teenage friend that's this electronics genius, you know, kind of like Otto from High School USA.
Sure, yeah.
It's like, yeah.
Yeah, he should have just built a robot.
So it was so bad, I didn't even finish it.
Wow.
So there you go. Do with that what you will. I mean, the kills in it are okay enough. The acting is okay enough. It's like they couldn't even be bothered with the science portion of it all. I don't know. It's a nitpick, and it's something only, you know, a middle-aged D-bag like me would, like, you know, really hammer on. But you know what? It
It bothered
it, it
you.
It bothered me.
Yeah, it snapped you out of the reality of the film, exactly. And therefore it's like you can't get it. I get it. I understand completely.
If it didn't bother to explain anything, like if she just happened to fall into this thing and just have to be in a time machine,
yeah,
I would have been fine with that. But the fact that you tried to explain some bullshit and it doesn't
jive.
So.
on my list, okay, so 2019, this movie is on HBO Max right now. It is called The Lodge.
So, how would you feel about going to the mountains for Christmas with Grace? She really wants to get to know you guys.
That's our mom's hat.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I don't want to leave you here with the kids if you're not feeling up to it.
I'm feeling fine. It was my idea and it took a couple days. I can do a couple days.
Have fun.
It's Christ.
Everyone committed suicide except for her.
Repent and you will find salvation.
Did you do that?
We didn't do anything.
We're leaving.
What are you talking about? Look outside. We're stuck here.
It's okay. Trust me. You have nothing to be scared about.
It starts off and there is, you know, Alicia Silverstone and her husband are separated and she drops the kids off and he's like, we need to have a talk. Look, I'm getting married in September. And she naturally, you know, drops the kids off, goes home, has a glass of wine, and then blows her own brains out.
Which, oh, shit.
Yeah. Heavy duty. Starts off heavy. Then you go through the funeral and the grief and the fact that the children blame the stepmom who, you know, it's obviously her fault that their mom killed herself, blah, 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 blah. Here's where it kind of starts to go off the rails, is that they go to this lodge, which is this really nice house in the middle of nothing. Nowhere, like legitimately, there's nothing around for miles, except for a Hardee's. But,
inside joke.
but Dad decides, you know what? I'm gonna leave you here with my two kids so that you two can kind of get to know each other and you can, you know, watch movies and talk and blah 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 blah. Well, I'm going to spoil the hell out of this movie because I hated it. So it turns out that they leave her there, and the oldest son, he's a complete piece of shit because he decides that he found out that the stepmom was actually raised in a cult and that she was, like, on medication and she'd gone through treatment. She was the only child survivor of this cult that committed a mass suicide. So that's it. She has massive psychological problem from all this, and he decides that he's going to show this girl what's what. He's going to convince her that they're all dead and in purgatory and that you know, what she needs to repent for what she did and the reason that, you know, she's the reason that Alicia Silverstone offed herself at the beginning and she's a terrible person. And they take her medications from her. They take all of her clothing. She decides she's going to try to, like, walk out through the snow, which is, like, 3 feet high. And she doesn't have her clothes because they took her coat and all this. So she's out there in a pair of boots wrapped in a blanket trying to get to the nearest town. She doesn't actually make it. They kill her dog. They leave it outside and it freezes to death. Yeah, these kids. But she comes back. And they're like, oh my God, we got to give her a pill. She's like completely, like, melted down. She's completely non-communicative, all this. And these kids get what they got coming because she gets the gun that's in the house and she shoots their dad when he comes back. And then, you know, the kids, they all die at the end. It's, yeah, this movie. It starts off so strong. The first 30 minutes of this, just like Vamp, it's enough to convince you that there might be a really good movie about to happen in front of you. But then it just gets bogged down in its own bullshit. And I knew what was going on. Like, the minute, like, they start, like, getting kind of weird and heavy with it, it's so ham-fisted in its screenplay and its directing at this point. And I'm just kind of like, the kids are doing it. And then I had to sit there and wait for another 45 minutes before they decided, yeah, the kids are doing it. And it's like, duh, you know? And so it's insultingly stupid. Alicia Silverstone is the best part of this movie. She knew when to check the out. I wish I had taken her advice and turned it off after the first 5 minutes. But it is absolutely, do not recommend. Do not buy the hype. It's got like a 74% on Rotten Tomatoes right now, but the audience score is 51%, and it deserves less than that 51%. This movie stunk. I hated everything about it. It felt like a complete overlong masturbatory waste of time. It felt like everybody in this movie just wanted to show you how good they are. Now, the sad part is that Riley Keough, I think, is the lead actress. She's the stepmom. She does everything she can with the material that she's given. It's just that the material isn't very good. Yeah. So
there you have it.
Yeah. Your turn.
So I went old school with this one. 1998's Urban Legend.
They are the legends we've all heard.
Gang members drive around at night with their headlights off. And when someone goes to flash from their high beams to warn them, they kill them.
A guy and a girl, and they're parked out in the woods. The guy steps out, and the girl starts to hear these scratching noises. It's her dead boyfriend hung from a tree.
Isn't there another story about a guy with an axe hiding in a woman's backseat?
The idea of an urban legend serial killer. It's a stretch.
Urban Legend.
Okay.
Yeah. I've seen the movie. I'm sure a lot of you guys have probably seen this movie if you're, you know, close to our age. It had like all the hot young talent at the time. It had, you know, Joshua Jackson, who's from Dawson's Creek. It had the Noxzema girl, Rebecca Gayhart.
Oh.
It had a very, very young Jared Leto in it. It had the guy who played Lex Luthor from Smallville, Michael Rosenbaum,
yeah.
I think is
yep.
what his name is, and a couple other people. And I kind of watched it just for nostalgia. It's like, this is kind of as bad as I remember it being. And Yeah, it was.
Does this fall into that I Know What You Did Last Summer thing? Because we watched that a while ago.
That's exactly what it is. Just like you said, you know, ever since Scream came out, you know, which was like 96 or some shit like that.
Something like that, yeah.
Somewhere around that time frame. Everybody tried to catch that, you know, lightning.
Ride that wave,
again,
yeah.
Try to ride it. At least they did, you know, they tried to change it up a little bit with each variation of it. And it was kind of interesting in that, you know, at that time there was a lot of urban legends. It's kind of like when urban legends really started to like, become kind of popular.
Yeah, yeah. The internet kind of started to fuel because the internet was just starting to take off. So there was all these urban legend websites floating around.
Exactly, yeah. It was like pre-creepypasta.
Yeah. I was going to say, like, I remember back then, like, legitimately communities were popping up around it because there's the urban legends where you live, and then all of a sudden you're finding out that, like, you know, other cities and other areas have their own completely different set of urban legends on there. So
Or just a different variation of that same urban legend.
Yeah. And so there was a bunch of sites that were, like, trying to catalog all of them and, you know, what the variations of it were and that sort of thing. So, yeah, no, I get exactly why they chose to do it. And why this seemed like a great idea on paper, anyway.
Yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't badly executed. It was executed fine, and the acting is fine in it. It's just the end is just dumb. You know, they did like the Scream type of ending. You know, oh well, so and so character did something in the past that affected my life, so I'm extracting my revenge on you. Spoilers, what it was our hero, I forgot her name, it doesn't f***ing matter. She's actually the most unlikable person this whole f***ing movie.
Neve Campbell?
No. I don't remember her name. Don't remember her name. It doesn't matter, because she's an unlikable, unsufferable bitch. And I kind of wish she would have died. But anyway, so her and the very first victim of the movie were, I guess, driving drunk or some shit like that. They had a car accident, and they killed Rebecca Gayhart's boyfriend.
And, you know, there's a lot of that going on in the 90s, drunk teenagers running people down and then having to pay for it.
Yeah. check out I Know What You Did Last Summer.
Shit, Creepshow 2, the very last bit of that. She runs over the guy on the side of the road, and he keeps popping up. Thanks for the ride, lady. So, turn your brights on. That's what I got. You know, Uber is a thing now. So
I don't know if you're our age and kind of nostalgic for stuff like this. It's whatever. I don't know. I can't be bothered like really hate it. I can't be bothered like really love it either.
It's background noise.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's background noise. Yeah. You got it. Sorry. I got nothing. I watched a bunch of turds here. Except for my last one.
Well,
I'm
going to say this. Next movie I got on my list is a 2020 film, so it's very, very recent. And it was on Prime. Mm-hmm. The name of the movie is Relic.
When was the last time you spoke to her?
It's been a few weeks.
Mom!
She called me a few weeks ago. I think she was scared. She thought someone was coming into the house.
Tea?
Do you know where you were, Mum?
I suppose I went out.
What's this?
I was on the property when your grandfather inherited it. His mind wasn't there in the end.
Everything all right, Gran?
I thought this was where it got in.
Who?
Whoever it was coming into the house.
Mum, what is it?
It's here. Under the bed.
There's nothing under the bed, Mum.
Will you check for me?
And not the Relic. Relic. It is an Australian film.
Is this the one where they're at the... Well, you'll tell me what
it is. No. Actually, what it is that there is a woman in her 80s who has disappeared, and she's been having memory issues, and so her daughter and granddaughter go there, and, you know, first they're, like, you know, expecting the worst, that they're going to, you know, go there and try to find out, you know, what happened, because she lives backed up to the woods, and she's lived by herself since her husband passed away, and she does turn up. And she acts like nothing happened, and she will not talk about where she's been or anything like that. And right. So they're assuming that she has Alzheimer's, and so the daughter is like, I think we maybe need to look into assisted living and you know, get you out of here, make sure that you don't hurt yourself, anything like that. It's all very believable setup. Mm-hmm. And then really creepy, weird shit starts to happen. And I'm going to leave it right there. I'm going to tell you this right now. This is a thinking person's movie. It is one of those movies that if you want to watch a film with a bunch of people and then sit around and talk about what did you think that movie was about, this is your jam. This movie, it's creepy. It runs a little long. In a perfect world, this movie would be about 10 minutes shorter. It doesn't overstay its welcome. It just feels a little drug out in the middle
like
section
two,
of it.
2 hour mark?
Actually, it's right at about 90 minutes. And okay. I feel like they stretched it to hit that 90 minute mark, and they could have done it in 80 minutes. But it is surprisingly effective. The performance are just incredible in this. And the ending of it is surprising and weird and satisfying, and it's the part of this film that when you see the ending of it, you're going to be like, okay, wait, we need to have a talk about this. What was that? What did you think that meant? It's strange. And like literally, like after I finished watching this film, I was throwing out like, do you think it meant this? Do you think it meant that? To Karen, like I gave her like 3 or 4 different scenarios of what I think it meant, and then I was like trying to like figure out like, okay, well this part I think means this. And this part means this. So it's a smart film, and it's one of those films that I'm definitely going to have to go back and watch again. But it's deep, it's heavy, it's very relatable. It's also like very true to life. You know, if you had a parent that was starting to, you know, show signs of Alzheimer's, and you're dealing with the fear that's ingrained with all that, and the fact that they live alone, and then add all the supernatural stuff on top of it, which it's never over the top supernatural. It's not spooky boo. Mm-hmm. It's shit happening that you don't quite see it, or you can't quite, but it's perfectly executed. It was far better than I was expecting, and I had no idea what to expect from it. But I'm going to say this. This is one of those movies that is directed by a woman. I can't remember her name. Michael, throw it right here. But I really want to see what she does next, because this was such a strong outing. Okay. So,
right on. My last one, again, it's not really so much the movie. It's the movie Christine.
Her name's Christine.
I like that.
I saw you guys at the football game.
How'd you get that car fixed up like that?
Oh, just plain old-fashioned hard work.
What do you know about that car?
I know that the guy who owned the car before Arnie, his daughter choked to death in Christine.
Actually, just got finished with the book because I never actually read the book. And I will say this: I think the movie does a really good. If you're not familiar with Christine, 85, I think, or something like that. John Carpenter.
Actually, 83. 80,
is it?
Yeah.
I'll throw it
up
here. Either way, John Carpenter. It's adapted of a Stephen King book. The car, you know, buddy finds the car, fixes the car up, car comes alive, car kills people. I'm just gonna leave it there. great movie. The book goes, you know, just like typical Stephen King, it goes into really in-depth detail, and sometimes detail that really has nothing to do with the basis of the story. And it really made me appreciate the movie even more, because like they distill that thing down to like it's bare flippin' essence of it. And there's some changes in it. It doesn't completely follow the book. Spoilers. In the book, Arnie doesn't actually do any of the killing. He's really not involved in it in any way, shape, or form. The previous owner of the car does. And so the previous owner of the car possesses Arnie at times, but he needs an alibi to do the killing. So they'll kind of possess Christine and drive Christine, and Christine will do the killing, Christine being in the car, and then Arnie will be somewhere else to have like an alibi, which was cool and interesting. But I like
the fact that just the car is haunted and it is doing it to defend Arnie.
In the movie.
I'm going to say that I think John Carpenter did what the editor at Random House didn't, is that he took exactly like The Shining. Mm-hmm. Kubrick took Steven Spielberg's basic idea, honed
Stephen
it,
King's.
and crystallized it, and got it down to its bare essence. Yeah. And while it's completely, you know, if you read the book, you'd be like, okay, yeah, I see where you got to, but this is not a one-to-one. But it doesn't make the film any less of a masterpiece. Christine, same thing.
It's a recommend for both. I did very much enjoy the book. I really did, but it was just, I was just really amazed at how, like you said, how he crystallized and like distilled it down to, like I said, just the bare essence. This is what you need in the story. It gets the point across, and it's a fantastic film. But the two things that I like that the movie did well that the book didn't do was describe how anime Christine is, like how she actually is alive and regenerates. Like that scene in the movie where after Buddy Repperton and his buddies like trash Christine. And then she puts herself back together.
Yeah.
That's like one of the best special effects shots ever in history.
And it's practical. It's all in camera and practical. And it's, John Carpenter is a master that was not appreciated in this time. I love Christine. Christine is legitimately one of my favorite John Carpenter films and one of my favorite Stephen King films. So I get it.
Yeah. So that's portrayed better in the film than it is in the book. Of course, you can visually see it, you know, obviously. But then also, the love that Arnie has for Christine is better portrayed in the movie than in the book. It's just like it's all over the place. Like, especially after, again, they trash the car and Lee comes up and is like, you know, hey, Arnie, what happened? And like, he like, just goes the off on her.
Yeah.
And like, I mean, Alexandra Paul is a very, very easy on the eyes.
Yes.
And yeah.
Still. Yeah. So
a very attractive lady. But yeah, he's like, you know, F you, get the mirror. It's all about me and the car. And that is better portrayed in the movie than I think in the book.
Yeah, I I've read a lot of Stephen King. I've never read Christine. It was kind of like one of those, after you see the movie, you're like, why do I need to read the book? So I'm glad you did the research on this one. But I'm just going to say that it's kind of like making me go, I'll stick with the movie. I'm good with that. If that's my official version of Christine, I'm comfortable with it.
And you can be, yeah. I mean, if you're curious, you know, absolutely check out the book. It's a solid book. But otherwise, yeah, watch the movie and you'll get everything you need in that movie.
So, and my last is an absolute recommend with a caveat. If you cannot do realistic depictions of very graphic violence, this is not for you. And the name of the film is Kill List. Karen didn't like it, but Karen was the first one who was like, it was a great movie. It was a really good movie. I never want to see it again. That was her takeaway on this one. And it's a simple setup. You have this hitman who botched a job in Kiev. And it has been 8 months since he has actually gone out and done any work. And then finally, his buddy, his partner hitman, the guy that he teams up with to actually go perform his hits, shows up and he's like, look, we got this job. It's a kill list. Three names on it. It's big money, and you know, you're having financial trouble. You're strapped. It's causing stress between you and your wife. Let's do this gig and get you back in the game. And it starts off as a very simple premise. It's two hitmen that like legitimately they're tight. They are the two guys that they're the only other person that understands the other, and they have like literal fist fights, knockdown, dragouts, trash the living room, rolling around, beating the crap out of each other. And then it cuts to them sitting there drinking a beer on the couch and one of them going, yeah, sorry about that. I'll replace it. And he's like, you know, Cher's going to know. Yeah, she knows everything. It's strangely endearing. All the relationships are established in very believable, very realistic, very satisfying ways. But then turns into something else, and it's subtle. It is one of these wonderful films, and I don't want to give anything away on this one. The less you know going into it, the more you're going to get out of it. But this is one of those perfect little films that it is a huge story told in a really small way, and that you have to extrapolate a lot of what's going on in the background, what the movie is really about.
Okay.
But they're focused on the relationship of these two guys doing this job. And you find out that the job is not at all what they're told it is. And the people that they're going after are not at all who, you know, they've been told that they were. And it's actually all part of this much larger, infinitely more up thing, and it's brilliant. It is actually quite possibly the best horror film I have seen this year. It's an Irish or a British film. I'm not sure which. I have no idea how this movie snuck under the radar. This film is legitimately a 9.5, possibly a 10 out of 10 for me. It is that good. It is immensely satisfying.
And
I have not bought it because I got to figure out where the hell to get it, because I don't know if there's a U.S. release of this film, but I will land one. If I got to order from the UK, I will. That multi-zone Blu-ray player is paying for itself at this point. But I'm just going to tell you this: like literally, this is a movie that is smart. It is well acted. It is perfectly directed. It is expertly edited. There is so much information that is like packed into every scene. There are these great funny moments. There are these super f***ed up moments. There is one of the most vile scenes I've ever seen in a film, and it was like one of those, it got me to like sit up and cover my mouth like, whoa, okay, what, wow, I really just saw that. It's parts of this are hard to watch. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it, but at the end of it you understand all the justifications for everything that's going on, and then when you realize what's actually going on, it is such a kick in the head. And when you, the ending, I'm just going to say that the ending will scar you. because no matter what you think is happening, it's one of those when you get to the ending and you see what actually has happened. And I know I'm being vague about this, but it's intentional because I don't want to spoil this. But when you see what happens, then you start thinking about all the shit that you just watched and all these like Legos start falling into place and you're like, oh, that's what this movie was about.
Well, I'm glad somebody got to watch some good movies because it certainly wasn't me.
I was going to say, there is so much, there are so many bad or mediocre or lazy horror films that are just like all over
see
the streaming services right now. It is hard to find some good ones. And I'm just going to say that you know, of the five that I gave you, there's one absolute avoid and four of them that there's a reason to watch. Mm-hmm. And it was actually more like I probably watched more like 13 or 14 movies to get to this list of five. But there was only one that I hated so much that I had to warn you about it, and that is The Lodge. So
Fair enough. All right. Well, hopefully you got something from this list. So if you didn't like our previous five films we reviewed, here's 10 more. And if you can't find anything in there, I got nothing for you.
Try Nick at Night. Yeah. all the sitcom Halloween specials are sure to be on.
Yeah. But throw some comments down there below. Tell us of some movies that maybe you'd like to see us review next year or just watch just because you enjoyed them or love them.
So, and that's it. We will catch you next time.